Hello, I'm Jesus Sainz. Welcome to the San Antonio International Airport. I'm the airport director, and I'm pleased to be standing here with Rob Lowe, the regional administrator for the FAA's Southwest region. We're here to invite you to sit back, relax, and learn more about the exciting proposal the FAA has for our community. It improves the way aircraft arrive and depart from our airport, which makes operations safer and also more efficient. Safer, more efficient arrivals and departures bring in more jobs, visitors, and business for our community.
That's right, Jesus. I'm excited to be here with you. It's our pleasure to work hand in hand with your team for the betterment of the San Antonio community. After all, nobody knows your community better than the people of San Antonio. The FAA is in the process of modernizing the national airspace system with the use of satellite-based navigation as the primary method of directing air traffic. It's replacing the conventional system, which includes ground-based navigational aids.
These satellite-based procedures are extremely precise. They give pilots and air traffic controllers greater situational awareness, which enhances safety, but also allows for enhanced route planning. This means passengers will see reduced delays at time of departure and reduced flying time to their destinations. An added benefit of less fuel burn means a reduction of carbon emissions. Using satellite-based procedures is also more cost-effective than the ground-based radar system.
We will focus on arrival and departure procedures in the airspace around San Antonio, and we will discuss what you might expect as these new procedures are introduced.
We know one of your concerns may be potential noise impacts of any changes in and around the San Antonio area. We share your concerns, and we want you to know that we do not want to bring unnecessary noise to the area.
Yes, absolutely, Jesus. We want you to know that we are performing an environmental assessment to analyze potential noise impacts. Once we have the results of that study, we will be sharing them with you. So let us tell you about this proposal. Here are two videos which will detail these proposed procedures. After the videos, we will go into a live panel question and answer period with subject matter experts from the FAA, along with our industry partners who are here to answer your questions about this project.
So sit back, relax, and get your questions ready. We hope this presentation and the live question and answer period will provide value to you and the rest of the community members. Thank you.
San Antonio, Texas has a rich heritage, and the San Antonio International Airport is the gateway to this vibrant community. The FAA is proposing to modernize the flight paths into and out of this airport. This proposal is part of a nationwide strategy to modernize the entire national airspace system. It would help bring in aircraft quicker and reduce delays. In the past, aircraft flew point to point, bypassing over ground-based navigational aids. However, many of these ground-based aids are now old, inefficient, and costly to maintain. Therefore, the FAA is proposing to replace them with satellite-based procedures. These new procedures allow pilots and controllers to use more direct routes, which can help the environment by reducing fuel burn. One of the procedure types, the Standard Terminal Arrival Procedure, or STAR, has built-in speed and altitude requirements, which are programmed into the airplane's flight computers. They allow the aircraft to essentially glide down on idle power. This is called an optimized profile descent, or OPD. It's like driving a car from a highway to an exit ramp and then a neighborhood street, but seamlessly and without stopping. Placing an aircraft on a continuous and predictable path improves safety and efficiency. San Antonio has three runways. Runway 422 runs southwest to northeast. Runway 13 right, 31 left runs from the southeast to the northwest. There is also a shorter parallel runway next to 13 right, 31 left, and it is designated as 13 left, 31 right. Aircraft take off and land into the wind, and runways are built to align with historic wind patterns specific to each airport. At San Antonio, winds primarily come from the southeast. However, winds can come from the north or even the west, which will change the direction in which the aircraft will take off and land. General runway identification is based on the compass heading the aircraft is facing as it lands or takes off. For example, runway 422 is facing approximately 40 degrees in one direction and 220 degrees in the opposite direction. If you drop the zero at the end of the compass heading, you will get 4 and 2-2. Even though a runway is a single strip of concrete, it is essentially treated as two separate surfaces. Parallel runways are further designated with L for left or R for right at the end of the runway number, which explains runways 13 right, 31 left, and 13 left, 31 right. Air traffic controllers work in three-dimensional space to keep planes safely separated vertically and horizontally. They continually space and separate arrivals and departures. Satellite-based procedures make that job safer and more efficient because the separation requirements can now be incorporated within the procedure. Creating and publishing new flight procedures is a multi-step process. Federal law and FAA policy requires the FAA to conduct an environmental review in accordance with the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA. We hope this video gives you a basic understanding of how the air traffic control system works in the San Antonio airspace. For more information, please visit the San Antonio page on the FAA's Community Involvement website.
Hello, my name is Travis Schulhorn, and I'm an air traffic control specialist at the FAA San Antonio International Airport Control Tower, or ATCT. I have been actively involved in air traffic within the San Antonio airspace for the last 12 years. We will walk you through the flight procedure poster boards for the proposed arrival and departure procedures at San Antonio International Airport. Each of the following boards shows a sampling of proposed approach and departure procedures. Most boards also show existing flight tracks. Each board will show either arrival or departure aircraft with current day tracks color-coded in blue. Each proposed arrival procedure will also be shown on two separate boards, one providing a zoomed out view and another showing a zoomed in view to show additional detail. The flight tracks and procedures are all overlaid on a map of the surrounding area. Each flight procedure board is oriented with north facing up. The name of each flight procedure is shown by an arrow on the map containing a five-letter name. Arrows for arrival procedures point towards the airport, while arrows for departure procedures point away from the airport. For example, this board shows five departures: the Alice, Yoda, Snyder, Timo, and Tejano. These are called SIDs, or Standard Instrument Departures. A few acronyms are used by air traffic controllers explaining the boards and in the text. The spelling of each departure procedure is limited to five letters. For example, the spelling of the Alice departure is pronounced Alice. The stars on the board are locations of waypoints, which are fixed navigational points in space that aircraft fly to. Just as with the spelling of procedures, waypoints are spelled with five letters. For example, the Tater waypoint would be pronounced Tater. The proposed flight procedures are colored purple for departures and orange for arrivals. These colored paths show the proposed flight paths. Surrounding the paths are dispersed path areas in either pink for departures or yellow for arrivals. These areas show the possible locations where aircraft may fly and account for the possibility of different routing to avoid hazardous weather, for operational need, or for safety. When aircraft fly in these areas, it is typically due to a pilot receiving a compass heading from air traffic control. A vector is a compass heading assigned to an aircraft by an air traffic controller at San Antonio TRACON or the airport tower. The proposed procedures will use satellites for guidance instead of ground-based navigational aids. For arriving aircraft, once the standard terminal arrival route, or STAR, controllers may give the pilot a vector to the final approach or fly the entire procedure and would be issued the RNP approach. RNP is an acronym for Required Navigation Performance that allows properly equipped aircraft to fly the precise routes all the way to the runway. San Antonio International Airport currently has four RNP approach procedures that are utilized by properly equipped aircraft. These are shown in teal on the maps. Aircraft arriving or departing may be vectored off their procedure for operational need, safety, or for hazardous weather. Aircraft that are vectored are given a different heading to fly than the published procedure. However, controllers would use these proposed procedures as published whenever air traffic conditions allow. The bullet points on the right side provide additional details about the procedure. This board shows an overview of the proposed arrival and departure procedures in the greater San Antonio area. These paths generally follow where aircraft arrive and depart today, especially in areas within a few miles of the airport. As we walk through the boards, we'll talk about each of the operational flows, which is what we call the primary direction aircraft arrive and depart. Primarily, aircraft land and depart into the wind. However, many other factors such as route of flight, weight of aircraft, runway closures, and velocity of wind are also considered, which permit aircraft to arrive or depart other runways to achieve operational advantages. For example, at San Antonio, aircraft may land on one runway and take off on another, such as landing on runway 13 right and departing on runway 4. This board shows an overview of the proposed arrival and departure procedures in relation to military airspace in the greater San Antonio area. Randolph Air Force Base is located 12 miles from San Antonio International Airport and is depicted on the map with the label RND. The large areas of military airspace depicted by the shaded regions are used for military training. The proposed procedures are designed to generally avoid these areas. However, civilian aircraft can fly through these military operation areas, or MOAs, if flying under visual flight rules. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed departure procedures called SIDs, for aircraft departing to the southeast on runway 13 right. Aircraft departing on runway 13 right will initially fly a compass heading given by an air traffic controller to a waypoint. This initial heading is called a vector. From the waypoint, aircraft will continue their departure by following the SID. Aircraft will continue to depart and climb out as they do today, close into the airport below 10,000 feet, while maintaining the existing voluntary noise abatement procedures. Runway 13 right is a commonly used runway because the winds are often from the southeast, and it is safest for aircraft to land and to depart into the wind. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed arrival procedures called STARS for aircraft arriving to the southeast on runway 13 right. Aircraft landing on runway 13 right will fly the STAR to a waypoint where they are then given a vector by controllers to the final approach to land. Aircraft will continue to arrive as they do today using similar routes. Just as aircraft depart on runway 13 right due to the direction of wind, aircraft also land on runway 13 right when the wind direction is from the southeast. This board shows a zoomed in view of the existing flight tracks and proposed STARS for aircraft arriving to the southeast on runway 13 right. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed SIDs for aircraft departing to the northeast on runway 4. Aircraft departing on runway 4 will initially fly a vector given by air traffic control to a waypoint. From the waypoint, aircraft will continue their departure by following the SID. Aircraft will continue to depart and climb out as they do today, close into the airport below 10,000 feet, while maintaining the existing voluntary noise abatement procedures. Aircraft depart on runway 4 year-round, flying initially to the northeast, joining a SID to guide them to their destination. The proposed SIDs are being implemented as part of the FAA's modernization of the National Airspace System. These SIDs are used by San Antonio International Airport, Randolph Air Force Base, as well as other smaller airports. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed STARS for aircraft arriving to the northeast on runway 4. Aircraft landing on runway 4 will fly the STAR to a waypoint and are then given a vector to the final approach to land. Aircraft will continue to arrive as they do today using similar routes. Aircraft arrive on runway 4 year-round when the winds come from the north. This board shows a zoomed-in view of the existing flight tracks and proposed STARS for aircraft arriving to the northeast on runway 4. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed SIDs for aircraft departing to the southwest on runway 22. Aircraft departing on runway 22 will initially fly a vector given by air traffic controllers to a waypoint. From the waypoint, aircraft will continue their departure by following the SID. Aircraft will continue to depart and climb as they do today close into the airport below 10,000 feet while maintaining the existing voluntary noise abatement procedures. Runway 22 is used when winds are from the southwest. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed stars for aircraft arriving to the southwest on runway 22. Aircraft landing on runway 22 will fly the star to a waypoint and are then given a vector to the final approach to land. Aircraft will continue to arrive as they do today using similar routes. This board shows a zoomed in view of the existing flight tracks and proposed stars for aircraft arriving to the southwest on runway 22. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed SIDs for aircraft departing to the northwest on runway 31 left. Aircraft departing on runway 31 left will initially fly a vector given by air traffic controllers to a waypoint. From the waypoint, aircraft will continue their departure by following the SID. Aircraft will continue to depart and climb out as they do today close into the airport, below 10,000 feet, while maintaining the existing voluntary noise abatement procedures. Runway 31 left is used when winds come from the north, which is typically during the winter months. This board shows a zoomed out view of the existing flight tracks and proposed stars for aircraft arriving to the northwest on runway 31 left. Aircraft landing on runway 31 left will fly the star to a waypoint and are then given a vector to the final approach to land. Aircraft will continue to arrive as they do today using similar routes. As with aircraft departing on runway 31 left, aircraft arriving on this runway is common in the winter months due to the predominant wind direction being from the north and northwest. This board shows a zoomed in view of the existing flight tracks and proposed SARs for aircraft arriving to the northwest on runway 31 left.
Hello, I'm Christy Rigotti and I'm an environmental protection specialist with the FAA in the Southwest region. Per federal guidance in the National Environmental Policy Act, referred to as NEPA, the FAA is required to evaluate categories of potential environmental, social, and economic effects of a proposed federal action. According to NEPA, these SIDs and STARs are a proposed federal action. The environmental level of review for this proposed action will be an environmental assessment, or EA. The EA is currently in process, and a draft EA is scheduled to be published for public review and comment later this year. More details of the public ability to review and comment on the EA will be made available on the project website.
Hello, I'm Rob Lowe. I'm the regional administrator for the FAA's Southwest region. Thank you for participating in our virtual public workshop. I will be your moderator for this discussion, and I look forward to hearing your questions about this proposal. You can submit those questions at any time by entering them into the chat section in Zoom. And if you're watching this on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube, you can enter your questions into the Google form that is on your screen. Please note that these forms are for questions about this proposal only. I will tell you about a separate form for comments later. Before we get started with questions and answers, I'd like to cover three procedural items. First, if you're having technical issues connecting to the workshop, you can text our tech support number anytime during the workshop at 949-478-0253. And as a reminder, for our audience that would like to listen in Spanish, in Zoom, click on Interpretation in the lower right of your screen, then select Spanish. To go back to English, click on Interpretation and select English. For our audience that would like to use closed captions, click on Live Transcript in the lower portion of your Zoom screen. Select Show Subtitle. To remove the closed captions, click on Live Transcripts and click Hide Subtitle again to turn them off. Second, this workshop will last for 60 minutes. We have two workshop schedules, one today and one tomorrow. So if you'd like, you can also attend our next workshop tomorrow. Third, we are also live streaming on FAA's Facebook and Twitter live feeds and the FAA's YouTube channel. A recording of this workshop will be available on these channels immediately after this broadcast. Now I'd like to introduce our panelists. First is Garrick Watson. Garrick is an airspace and procedure support specialist at the San Antonio International Airport Air Traffic Control Tower. Also from the Air Traffic Control Tower is Travis Uhlhorn, an air traffic controller right here in San Antonio. Stephen Southers is joining us from the San Antonio International Airport. We also have Trey Turner, pilot for Southwest Airlines. And our last panelist is Vivian Nichols, our Spanish language interpreter. We are very excited to discuss some work we are proposing at San Antonio and then answer your questions. I want to make sure that everyone also understands this is the beginning of the conversation, not the end. As the project progresses, there will be other opportunities for the community to learn more, to ask questions, and potentially comment on more formalized designs. Everyone you see on this meeting today is committed to continue this meaningful dialogue with communities. So, and to that end, let's get to your questions. First question comes in, looks like it's Travis, this one looks like it'd be in your area. Here's the viewer's question. How do aircraft use satellite procedures to navigate? And how is it different than ground navigation?
Well, as far as for the airplanes go, it's much like your car. They have a GPS system in the airplane. There's some benefits to that other than using the ground base is that ground based would be line of sight, which kind of, depending on altitudes and stuff, it can restrict how well they receive the signal. With GPS location, it's coming from above and they can get it no matter how low they are. It's much more precise and it gives us a lot more leeway when we build these procedures of how we can maneuver airplanes in and around San Antonio.
Okay, great. Thanks, Travis. Well, the questions are coming in fast, and that's awesome. We look forward to getting more. So please enter your questions as we go along. Here's another one. Let me take a shot at this one. It says, is the FAA conducting an environmental review to comply with the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA? Yes, we are. For this project, we are conducting an environmental assessment, or an EA, that will evaluate numerous environmental resources in our evaluation, such as air quality, noise, environmental justice, and biological resources. Here's our next question. And Stephen, looks like this one might fall into your area of expertise. It says, will the noise abatement procedures remain in place with these new procedures, especially in the early morning and late night hours?
Yes, Rob, the voluntary noise abatement departure procedures will remain in place. And they're available for the pilots to use both morning and night and all day long.
Great. Thanks, Stephen. Appreciate that. So Trey from Southwest Airlines, I've got one here that directed specifically to you, sir. It says, can we ask the pilot, how do these procedures benefit you as pilot of the aircraft?
Thanks, Rob. You know, with the PBN procedures that we're talking about, the benefits to the pilots are really a reduction in workload, and it also allows us to utilize the what we call the highest level of automation in the airplane. The way these procedures tie into the automation of the airplane is, as far as a workload reduction goes, is really what we try to utilize the most in terms of whether it be either the departures, the arrivals, or approaches.
Great. Thanks, Trey. Appreciate that. So folks, thank you for those great questions. They continue to come in and we've got a number already in the queue that we'll get to. But don't forget, you can submit your questions at any time by entering them into the chat section in Zoom. Or if you're watching on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube, you can enter those questions into the Google form that's on your screen. So let's jump to the next question. Garrick, looks like this one might fall into your area, sir. Says, how do these new procedures affect military operations? Do they only use Randolph or do they also take off and land at San Antonio?
So the aircraft at Randolph predominantly use Randolph Air Force Base. There are very few occasions where they come over to San Antonio. Some of those occasions might be like, for example, this last Friday, Randolph Air Force Base was closed, and there were two beach jets, BE-40s, that landed at San Antonio, and they stayed there for a certain mission. And they just stayed there for the weekend. They departed, went on a mission, and they landed actually today back at Randolph Air Force Base. Now, for the current operations, the procedures that we're proposing were designed specifically around the current and existing operations are at Randolph Air Force Base and all the military operations. So any of the flight paths for the military are not changing.
All right, thanks, Garrick. Appreciate that. So here's our next question. Can you elaborate on the noise part of the EA? Let me take a shot at that. So when we do our environmental assessment, we look at several factors during that process. We factor in air traffic operations, in fleet mix, the type of aircraft involved in that mix. We look at where the aircraft are currently flying, comparing that new procedure or procedure change. We factor in runway usage as well as other factors. So all those go together in our process as we look at noise and other parts of the environmental assessment. So Travis, here looks like a good question for you, sir. The viewer says, there is a lot of us general aviation folks around the area. Will this affect how GA aircraft get to and from the local airports?
Not really. So even if you are flying the new procedures that are being designed, they're pretty much following the same flight track path that we already are doing. Like Garrick said, we built these around our existing military procedures, which is a huge part of our airspace in the approach control airspace, or a huge user of the airspace around San Antonio is the military. The military procedures didn't change. These new procedures are really going to follow a lot of the same paths that we already are tried and true stuff that we've been doing for years. As far as, you know, the general aviation and whether you would get one of these procedures or not, a lot of that is going to depend on what type of airplane you're flying. So if you're flying, a Skyhawk, a 172, these procedures really, the departures will apply to you because they're not like a climbed via. If you have an RNAV suitable system, you can go direct to a waypoint and join that departure path. You will continue to get those just like you do today. As an arrival, your Skyhawk, obviously is not going to meet a lot of the altitude and speed restrictions on the arrivals. So the existing arrivals that we have now, some of those will be kept. We're still trying to work on that process of how we will assign the arrivals that cannot comply with the speed and the altitude restrictions here. But more than likely, a lower and slower airplane, you're going to pretty much come in and leave just like you do today. If you're flying faster, higher flying airplanes, you will get these new arrivals. But again, they're pretty much going to mimic the way we're bringing you in today.
Great. Thanks, Travis. Appreciate that detailed explanation. That's awesome. Sure. So folks, don't forget, you can continue to enter your questions. Thank you for the ones you've already submitted. We will work our way through all of those, but we want you to not leave today with a question unanswered. So please enter your questions. The Zoom Q&A button on Zoom or on social media. Don't forget, you can use the Google form that's there. So Garrick, this viewer says, I live southwest of the airport, and depending on the time of year, it seems like certain flight procedures are used more than others. How do the airlines decide which procedure to use and which runway to use to take off and land?
All right, so the runway decision is primarily made by air traffic control tower. And if the airline, if the pilot is requesting something other than that, we'll determine the safety of it. And if it's an operational need, we'll try and accommodate to that as much as possible. So the control tower is the one. And what we do is we advertise on the radio on a certain frequency, and it's broadcast constantly to the pilots. So before they even enter our airspace, the pilot is prepped and knows exactly what they need to do and what approach they're going to be commencing and what runways in use. The other question referenced the Southwest and the time of year. It's very seasonal. So as the pre-recorded message at the beginning of this stated, that aircraft will land and depart into the wind. So unbeknownst to some people, we do consider San Antonio having multiple seasons. Some will question that, but we do have different seasons. And so we'll just say, like now we're in May going into June, and the wind is predominantly to the south and southeast, as opposed to the winter months. We'll just go with January. The wind is out of the north and the northeast. So if you're to the southwest, you will be observing more aircraft to the southwest of San Antonio arriving to the northeast. And as Travis has stated, on runway 4, because they're going to be landing and departing into the wind.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. I appreciate that. Great, great explanation. And I think that really helps our viewers get a picture of how the pilots and the aircraft operators work together with air traffic control. Thanks for that. So speaking of pilots, Trey, this viewer wants to know, will this change how pilots fly?
Thanks, Rob. The short answer to that question is no, it doesn't. For us, these new procedures, especially on the RMP side, is just for us, it's basically just like flying a GPS approach in terms of the pilot workload and the automation that goes into flying it. At least I can only speak for my company, but we are all trained and qualified to fly RMP procedures. So short answer is no. I mean, we're going to keep doing what we've been doing.
Great. Thanks, Trey. Appreciate that. But Travis, this question is one that maybe I would ask if these procedures were over my house. And it says, what size planes will be flying above our house when this project is done?
So really the same ones that are flying over there today, they'll just be using a GPS-based signal, if you will, instead of a ground-based signal, but it'll be the same airplanes that are flying in and out of there today.
Okay, great. Thanks, Travis. Now, Garrick, let me come back to you if I can. A minute ago, you talked a little bit about how the system decides on runways and winds and how we work together. This viewer said, there's no mention of Kelly Field or Stinson Field. How do they fit into the instrument departure and arrival procedures we're talking about?
Yeah, good point. So the existing arrival and departure procedures for Stinson and Kelly are not going to change. Everything is going to be strictly the same. We have connectors that for the new, some of the new procedures that we'll be able to utilize. And after the end of that connector, what we do, the arrival, I'll just say for aircraft, it brings the aircraft into our airspace. And depending on where this aircraft is going, whether it's going to be Kelly Air Force Base or Stinson Airfield, the controller will then issue vectors, turns, also known as headings, using the compass to get that aircraft to its destination. So there really won't be any many changes to because Kelly and Stinson, as opposed to San Antonio, we're having new approaches. Stinson and Kelly will not be in this. They have their current existing approaches, procedures, and they will not be changing at all.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. Appreciate that. So folks, don't forget, you can continue to submit your questions at any time by entering them into the chat section in Zoom, or if you're watching this on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube, use the Google form that's on your screen. Now, here's a question from a viewer that says, the slides just presented are very blurry and of little help to understand these proposed changes to takeoff and landing routes. Is there a posted slideshow that we can access to see sharper images? Well, actually, yes, this workshop is being recorded, as I mentioned earlier, and it can be accessed on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter immediately after this workshop live session ends today. So feel free to go back, watch it again. And once you watch the recorded version, you can pause and look and see. I think you'll find the pictures are fairly clear when you get a chance to see them that way. So this next question, Travis and Garrick, I'm going to kind of throw it to both of you as our air traffic control experts and let you guys kind of sort it out. Maybe Travis, if you want to start out. The viewer says, will the Cerveza make the arrivals on runway 4 always on the same glide path 5 miles or so out? And will there be spread on that path so that planes don't go over the same housetops all the time?
Yeah, sure. So really the final approach path to the runway doesn't change. It's the same as it is today. By definition, the final approach path is when you are aligned with the runway. Since the runways obviously aren't moving, those final approach paths are not going to change. And See, the second part of that question was, will it be spread out? No, it won't be spread out. It's still the same final approach path as we have today. And that's not just for runway four, that's for all of the runways. As far as the glide path over the same houses glide path, all of the procedures are designed with a 3-degree glide path. That's standard every airport out there. The final approach path is a 3-degree glide path.
Great. Thanks, Travis. Garrick, anything from a procedure development standpoint that you'd like to add there?
I think Travis pretty much hit the procedures as well. So it's, as he stated, 3 degrees descent. And so every aircraft that is going to be flying that certain procedure or instrument approach procedure is going to be on that existing glide path.
Great. And I believe that all of our existing instrument landing system, ILS approaches we use today, that's all 3 degrees. So 3 degrees is no different than what we've used across the system for a long time, right?
Correct.
Great. Correct. Awesome. Travis, here's another question that may fall into your area. It says, will this method potentially increase traffic?
No, they're not really designed to increase traffic, really just make it more efficient for the users. When they are coming into the airport, in and out of the airport, our separation standards are still the same. This does not change separation standards at all.
Okay, great. Thank you. Garrick, how about maybe this one might fit for you, sir. It says, general aviation seems to be underrepresented here. As a retired airline pilot flying out of 1T7, Bolverde, how will this impact our operations, and do you plan to expand the Class C airspace?
Good question. So we appreciate the general aviation, just as we appreciate all the airlines and all the business companies that fly in and out of San Antonio. You guys are very, very important to us. And our objective is to whoever comes in our airspace, or we will treat them the same and give them the same safety and A-class service that we always attempt to provide. So coming out of Bolverde and 1Tango 7, it's primarily those aircraft are using visual flight rules. In other words, they're using the ground. They can essentially get a roadmap and fly their way to and from. So they have to have good visibility when those aircraft are in and out of Bolverde. I'll just say, for example. So these procedures are primarily for instrument flight rules, where aircraft will be using these predetermined routes, using their instruments, and coming into San Antonio, whether it be something or predominantly San Antonio is what I'll just say is coming into San Antonio. And so it's not really going to affect the operations. And I think there's something about the Class C. I see that my question is paging up here. If I remember right, they were talking about the Class Charlie surface area. The airspace is not changing. There is zero proposal for airspace change. All this is having to do with the approach and the arrival and departure procedures in and out of San Antonio.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. I appreciate that. We have another related question that's come in, and I think you answered most of it. This one is the airport manager at Kestrel Air Park, 1Tango 7. And he talks again about proposed changes to Class C airspace in San Antonio, which you just addressed, that we're not changing that. But he has a little bit of a different iteration in the back end of his question. And he says that they are, this is the reader writing, he says, we are very familiar with the SIDS and STARS, but we worry a bit about the low-level, high-speed operations of the T-38s out of Randolph. So can you, maybe you and Travis or Garrick, if you want to start, talk a little bit about what are these proposed changes? Will they change how the T-38s and the Randolph operation operates and how it might change the overall flight patterns near Kestrel Air Park?
Yeah, I'll take that, Travis. This is ongoing because that airport is underlies the final approach course to Randolph Air Force Base from when aircraft are landing to the southeast, equivalent to San Antonio landing on runway 13 right from the northeast to the southeast. So Kestrel Air Park and Bolverde Air Park are underlie the final approach course. And so that is and always has been kind of, I would just say, people try to watch out for that. We know that Randolph Air Force Base actually goes out to these airports and they try to talk to the pilots and the people around there and discuss the trying to let them know, hey, we are low. And because he's just said it's low flying aircraft. Yes. Yeah, so the aircraft are close into Randolph Air Force Base. So they do have to be low to find, you know, what we talked about earlier about the 3-degree descent rate coming into San Antonio. Those aircraft, those military aircraft are high performance. And yes, like a T-38 is fast. So they do have to be low and they have to hit that 3-degree descent rate to get into Randolph Air Force Base. So at that point where those aircraft are flying over Kestrel and Bulverde, they are low to meet that descent rate. So that will not change. Those procedures will not change. The only procedures that we're talking about changing are the procedures in and out of San Antonio.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. I appreciate that detailed explanation. And folks, really the key is there, what Garrick finished with, that what we're proposing here is not going to change the Randolph flight paths and how they relate to Bulverde and Kestrel Air Park. So thanks, Garrick. I appreciate that.
Hey, and folks, don't forget.
Yes, Travis, right, go Rob, ahead.
I want to add just a little bit of that to that, because I think I know where some of the confusion may be coming from. I recognize some of the names on here. I'm a local general aviation pilot myself, active flight instructor, learned to fly out of Stinson Airport. And so I'm pretty active in the general aviation community here.
Right.
So I can assure you, as someone who helped design the procedures, that general aviation was definitely taken into account. And while everything that Garrick said is absolutely true, that it's not going to really affect, nothing's changing for Kestrel, Bulverde, anything like that. They don't currently have any arrivals or departures that serve them, nor do they have any instrument approach procedures. The flight routes over those airports are not going to really change. The question that keeps coming up about the airspace is, I did see there was an email thread that went out. I don't want to go too far off topic, but there's a separate project where there was some questions about changing airspace that it's a totally unrelated to these procedures. And I think someone I saw the email thread there kind of thought that they were together and merged. And these are two totally separate topics that are completely separate from one another. So I just want to clear that up because I know that's probably what they're asking about.
Well, great. Thanks, Travis. I really appreciate that. And again, folks, we're not redesigning the Class C airspace at all here. So what we're talking about here today are the procedures in and out of San Antonio. So Travis, thank you for that. And thanks for reinforcing our adherence to and really desiring to get the feedback from all aspects of the community, general aviation, military, commercial, all of it. Everybody shares the operation in the National Airspace System. And we truly look to accommodate and provide that service to everyone and really desire your feedback. And speaking of that, don't forget, you can continue to put your questions in the chat on Zoom or via the Google form if you're on social media. Please do that. So the questions continue to come in. So Trey, I have one for you, sir. It says, how does a pilot fly an RNP versus being vectored? And can all of Southwest Fleet fly these RNP procedures?
Thanks, Rob. Well, so there's really two separate things. RMP is a type of approach, and yes, 100% of Southwest Fleet and pilots are equipped and trained to fly RMP procedures, respectively. We do have that op spec, and we plan to continue using as many RMP procedures as we can throughout the NAS. Now, vectoring, I don't want to step on, Garrick or Travis with this, but vectoring is really an air traffic tool to get an airplane in position to execute a certain type of approach. And we do experience that throughout the National Airspace System quite often. But where you see some of the, I think where this question is headed, and correct me if I'm wrong, but really what you see with a lot of RMP procedures is the ability for an air crew to, with an ATC assignment, but the ability for an air crew to start the RMP approach while being delivered directly from the arrival or the star. And that's really where we see a lot of operational benefits for them. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks, Trey. Appreciate that. So for Travis, here's another one that looks like it fits right into the air traffic control world. A viewer says, I saw the term OPD in the video. Can you talk about what that is and how airplanes will land?
Yeah, so the OPD, optimized profile descent. So today, when aircraft come over to us, they're assigned an altitude from the en route environment. Generally for us, from our, let's just take the, from the Northeast, the most common arrival point, they'll be coming to us at 13,000 feet. That's the top of our airspace. And then we will assign them an altitude. Generally 6,000 feet is what our feeder controller is giving the final approach control, airplanes at 6,000 feet. One aircraft may descend very quickly to 6,000 feet. Another aircraft may descend very slowly to 6,000 feet. And so I've got about, 30 or 40 miles of kind of guesswork of how quickly is this airplane going to descend. Furthermore, the aircraft, I may not need them to descend as quickly, or I may need them to descend quicker in certain instances. What this optimized profile descent does is it adds kind of check marks along that route to ensure that airplanes are going to hit each one of those waypoints at specific altitudes. So it gives me a little bit more as the controller, I know exactly what altitude they're going to be at what waypoint along there so that I can use that for separation purposes with other aircraft. And they're built to be, optimized as in that's kind of where the airplane would want to be based on different wind situations, different weights of the airplane. These procedures have been flown in a simulator and the simulator has shown this is where the airplane would want to be. And so it's more efficient for the aircraft and it helps me be more efficient working other airplanes around them.
Great. Thanks, Travis. So Trey, let me ask you this same question. Travis talked a little bit about from the air traffic standpoint and a little bit about from the operator standpoint. Anything you'd like to add from the operator or pilot perspective to the OPD question?
Well, and that's what we'd like to see. Really, this is where you get into, optimum being the key. We'd like to come down from altitude in our types of aircraft, heavy jet aircraft. We like to descend at idle. And when you descend at idle, you're burning less fuel, you're reducing the carbon emissions into the atmosphere, and you're reducing noise. And so we, from an operator standpoint, that's what we like to see as far as when the FAA implements procedures that are OPDs.
Great, thanks. And Trey, this one, while you've got the mic, if you don't mind, this viewer says, will STARS allow for quieter landings? Kind of a related question.
Yeah, along the same lines, designed in an OPD fashion, it really does. STARS, when you look at, how big a procedure a STAR can be, it really allows for an airplane to come out of altitude, come out of Mach and descend, into the terminal environment and lower to the ground. And, again, just mapping back to, my previous statement, with the closer we can get to the airplane descending at idle and for as long as possible, avoiding level segments and so forth that require throttling up, that's where we really like to be with these STARS. And so quieter landings coming from the STARS, STARS connecting to the approaches, I would say that's the goal.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate that. And folks, don't forget, we talked earlier about the environmental assessment that we're doing. As part of this process, the results of the noise analysis will be available as part of that environmental assessment as well, as we begin to look at exactly what Trey and Garrick and Travis are describing for us here this afternoon. So don't forget to keep sending your questions in. We look forward to answering those. We've got a number here already in the queue, but we don't want you to leave today without having your question answered. So Travis, here's a question from a viewer that says, will these procedures be used for all aircraft, turbine as well as piston aircraft?
Certainly for the turbine aircraft. There's still a couple of parts that we have not completely nailed down as far in the design procedures, as far as who will use them. Some airports that have these, they say, hey, if you can't meet these altitude restrictions, then we will use an alternative arrival, or you'll be basically just on a vector instead of an arrival. Some of them say if you can't meet certain speed restrictions, we're still working with our surrounding airspace and the en route controllers working on how we would want that, but I would venture to say that pretty much any turbine aircraft will probably use these, at least the arrival and the departure points. The ones that will be in question still that we haven't quite nailed down yet would be the slower turbine aircraft, maybe some of the smaller Citations, Eclipse jets, Vision jets, and then turboprop aircraft, some of the faster turboprops such as Piaggios, TBMs, things like that. Some of them can absolutely maintain these jet speeds, and we just have to determine which one we're going to do with them.
Okay, great. Thanks, sir. I appreciate that. Let's see, Travis, while you've got the, let me see here. The questions are jumping. They're coming in so fast, my questions are jumping around. So I apologize for that, folks. Let me slide back here a little bit. But Travis, it looks like this is a related question. We sort of addressed it earlier, but this viewer says, will any of the San Antonio Class C protected airspace altitudes change? So a little bit of a twist on what we talked about earlier.
Sure. Yeah. So again, I think a lot of the confusion has come from that someone may have confused this project with a Class C discussion. There is an ongoing work group that is exploring if our Class C, as currently depicted, is effective. In the purpose of Class C is to, you know, protect the users going into the primary airport. There is an active work group on a completely separate project that is exploring potential changes, but there is no changes yet, and there were certainly none of the no changes have been made to the Class C in relation to this, nor are there any firm plans on changing it at the time.
Great, thank you. Appreciate that. Definitely not connected to these proposed procedures at all. Absolutely. So here's a question. Our viewer says, "Sorry, I missed the first 20 minutes. Will there be a replay link available?" So don't forget, yes, this workshop is being recorded, and you can access it on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter immediately following this workshop today. So please feel free to access that. You can run it back. You can stop, play forward. You can pause and look at the graphics. Great opportunity all along there. And we did have a question, another related question. Somebody asked about a street level view of the current and proposed flight path. So I would encourage you to take advantage of those recorded sessions on social media and stop and look at, you can pause it and maybe zoom in, especially if you're on a computer. You can zoom in a little bit. It's not a perfect street level like a visual satellite camera view, but you can expand out, and there are some indicators on those graphics that give you a relationship of where it is to the airport at San Antonio or Randolph, et cetera. So please take a look at that. And we've got another question here that relates to that a little bit. And Steve, maybe I'll get you to help me with this one if you don't mind. I'm going to start it. It says, if someone wants to make a noise complaint, how do they do that? So I believe that, Steve, you do that that's your day job, right? And so I believe that citizens can contact either the San Antonio Airport, which they would likely get you, or go to the FAA. If they contact the FAA, you can go to faa.gov/noise. And there's a wealth of information on that page, as well as a link to get you to a place you can enter some information. But Steve, talk to us a little bit about how folks can get a hold of you there at the airport if they want to talk about noise.
We have a noise hotline here at the airport. The number is 210-361-9632, 361-9632. And the FAA ombudsman number is 202-267-3521. You can call either number. We'll try to help you as much as we can.
Yeah, absolutely. And don't forget also, there's the faa.gov/noise. A lot of information there. There's a lot of FAQs that might answer your question. And then there's also an opportunity to enter your information into a noise portal via your computer. Or like Steve said, you can call us on the phone either way. So Steve, thank you very much. So Trey, looks like this next question from our viewer might fall into your area. It says, for the new arrival procedures, how do the aircraft descent rates and speeds differ from legacy procedures?
Thanks, Rob. So keeping everything equal with the airplanes, you know, we're gonna be flying our optimum econ speeds, and that's largely gonna be dependent on atmospheric factors, winds, and then, you know, some airplane factors. So keeping all that equal, the speeds and the descent rates should not change. If I'm reading the question correctly, then really what should be changing is that it's more optimized so that we can keep a continuous descent versus planning our descent around multiple level offs.
Great. Thanks, Trey. Appreciate that. Here's one. Let me take a shot at this one. The viewer says, can you describe the process that will occur after these workshops? You bet. So we talked earlier a little bit about the environmental assessment. So the environmental assessment, or the EA, it's currently in process. When the draft EA is complete, it will be available for the public to review and comment. We also plan to host workshops during the EA comment period. The draft EA is then updated and a final environmental assessment is prepared. After the environmental process is complete, then the new procedures discussed today will move to the facility preparation and publication phases of the project. So the two interact together, and you can kind of see how they work together, and eventually we get to the preparation and publication phase down the ways. But there's opportunities for you to see the draft EA, and we certainly want your comments there as well. We'll talk more about that later in the session today. So Garrick, here's one for you, sir, if you don't mind. It says, when you say these procedures are safer, what does that mean? Is it safer for the passengers or the people on the ground?
Safe overall. The procedures, old and the new and old procedures, are both extremely safe. They're both going to provide a predictable flight path in and out of San Antonio. Where we're coming up differently from the new procedures is the precision of the ground-based navigation aids. They diminish based on distance. So just for an example, I was driving down to the coast today, this last weekend, and I was listening to a radio station. The further away I got from San Antonio, the weaker the signal, the weaker the station. So I had to tune into another station. And so that's what actually what a pilot does with ground-based navigational aids. Is what they do. They go from one station to the next. Whereas opposed to these new procedures, it's all satellite based. Line of sight is a big issue. In other words, terrain, any kind of obstruction, towers, they impede on things from a ground-based navigational aid. Well, satellites are above us and they're coming, they're aimed straight down. And so the aircraft do not have any obstruction receiving these signals. And so that creates a lot of precision and accuracy. I think so. The current thing, it's going to be completely safe for both the users of the aircraft and then the aircraft themselves, the companies and the jets and any of the general aviation, they're going to be able to fly these procedures.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. Appreciate that. Now, Trey, I know that you've had some experience with similar processes in other parts of the country. We've got a viewer that's asking, has the FAA made these kind of changes at other airports?
Yes, just in our observation, there have been projects across the National Airspace System that we've seen similar airspace redesigns and more performance-based navigation implementations. Quite a few places across the country, in fact.
Great. Thank you. And we heard Garrick just talk a minute ago about the satellite based portion of it and how that's different. And so that all works together and it's happening here at San Antonio, proposed changes similar to what's been implemented in other parts of the country. So it's all about updating and improving the National Airspace System and improving the efficiency and most importantly, safety of our system across the country. Now, here's an interesting question that Garrick, maybe I'll start with you and Steve and Trey. I'd be interested in all of your thoughts on this one, if you don't mind. So, Garrick, let's start with you. It says, how has the FAA, let me jump questions here. Are you putting these procedures into San Antonio so San Antonio can operate more flights? Excuse me. That's the question.
Okay. So these procedures are not necessarily designed to increase the number of flights. We at San Antonio, kind of a little bit of a background, depending on the runway in use for that day or at that time, we coordinate with the facility that we're receiving the aircraft from. And we set a number of aircraft per hour based on the runway in use. And we can only get so many aircraft in at the same time. And so we do have to have them separated. We do have separation standards, and those standards are not changing, will not change. And so those numbers really don't change. We don't increase the numbers. It's just making it safer, more efficient. And as I think Trey had the question earlier about OPD, optimized, it's very, very efficient.
Awesome. Great. Thanks, Garrick. Appreciate that. So Steve, how about from an airport perspective? What's the perspective on adding more flights in these new procedures?
I think it will actually get the airports in line to arrive at the airport in an orderly fashion, and it may help with arrival times. So we're hoping for that.
Right. Trey, any perspective from an operator standpoint as far as adding more flights with these procedures?
Well, it's falling in line with what the other two gentlemen said. It's not really, adding more flights for us, but it's increasing and building upon. Obviously we value safety first, but we want to increase and build upon, the efficiencies that the designers can build into these procedures.
Great. Thank you. Thanks all three of you for that. Now, Travis, here's a question we haven't dealt with today. I don't think it was in the initial video a little bit, but when are these procedures scheduled to start?
Summer of 2023 is the planned implementation.
Okay, great. Thank you. And Travis, here's another one. What happens if the satellite network goes down? What kind of backup does the FAA have to direct airplanes?
So there will still be some ground-based navigation aids available. They're just being reduced, but they're still going to be there. They can be used in backup. And, we still have radar. We can still see airplanes. We can still talk to the airplanes. And, worst case scenario, we are just issuing vectors or directing them which way to fly on their compass, and we'll still get them in.
Great. Awesome. Thank you. Steve, here's a question that maybe you can help me with. The viewer is asking about noise abatement procedures. They say, can you tell us what the existing arrival and departure noise abatement procedures are?
Yes, I can, but I'm going to have to read it. Noise sensitive areas exist on all sides of the airport. At the pilot's discretion, he will climb as quickly and quietly as safely possible on departure and use consideration when flying over populated areas by minimizing flight and high power settings. So most pilots nowadays know that there are noise sensitive areas around landlocked airports. And so they try to implement this as much as they can, considering safety is the highest concern.
Great. Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. So Garrick, here's a question that talks a little bit about procedure development a little bit. So it says, when a plane is about 2,500 feet, will it be arriving at an unchanging path on the runway about 5 miles away? In essence, will it fly above the same houses every time?
Okay, so based on the 2,500 feet, the aircraft, based on 2,500 feet, the aircraft is already established straight into the airport. And so essentially there's really no change to the aircraft's flight track at 2,500 feet because they're already established straight in for whatever runway's in use at the time. And that coincides with that 3-degree glide path because the aircraft has to get down to be able to receive that glide path. And so at 5 miles, well, let's say even 6 miles out, the aircraft is going to be established on final, depending on which runway is in use. The aircraft is going to be established on final straight in. And so those will not be changing.
Great. Thank you. So Travis, we mentioned earlier, I think you and I were talking a little bit about instrument landing systems in addition to the PBN procedures we're here. And we have a question about that. The viewer says, is there any discussion of decommissioning instrument landing systems at San Antonio International when these updated arrival procedures are implemented?
No discussion of that. No plan to do that at San Antonio right now. To go even a little further on that, we actually even redesigned some of those ILS procedures, still using the instrument landing system, but actually just updating some of the waypoints along those ILSs, because we fully intend to continue to use those.
Great, thank you. And I think the person that asked that question probably understands where the ILS system is, but the instrument landing system is really kind of that last little bit as they approach the runway, right, where it corrects, it gives them vertical and lateral guidance. And the procedures we're talking about here today get them to those points and help you along with working with you as controllers to get them to those points to make those landing on the ILS, right?
Yes, it gives them vertical and lateral guidance all the way down the runway so they can effectively land. You know, at San Antonio, the way our procedures are set up, they can get all the way down to 100 feet above the ground completely using that system. If they don't have the runway in sight or the runway environment in sight by 100 feet, they're going to go around. But that is essentially what that ILS system does. It guides you through the fog, through the rain, the clouds, low visibility, all the way down to the runway.
Great. And so, Travis, you led us right into the next question, if you don't mind to take this one as well. It says, can these procedures be used in all types of weather? And do thunderstorms affect the use of these procedures?
So they can be used in all types of weather. However, most pilots don't want to fly through certain types of weather. So, you know, if there's a thunderstorm approaching the airport, generally what we are doing is we're looking at that on our radar from a bird's eye view, and planning on which way that weather is moving. And just like Garrick talked about earlier, the winds generally shift with certain types of weather, especially thunderstorms. And we're aware of it. We know the wind shift is coming. We know where the weather's at. And that's part of what we do. We move airplanes around that weather. They could fly through it. Maybe if it's just rain, generally they will fly through that. And these procedures are not going to be affected at all by any sort of weather. It just may be pilot's prerogative to not want to fly through certain types of weather.
Gotcha. Perfect. Thank you very much. So Garrick, here's a question that talks about the difference between approach and arrival. So the question is, the words arrival and approach were used. What's the difference?
All right. A standard terminal arrival route is a procedure that brings the aircraft, for cruise flight to a point near the airport. And then an approach will take the aircraft from that point a few thousand feet above the ground down to the runway. So a star is going to be, like I said, the star is like, I'll just say, for example, what we have currently is a normal route is from over San Marcos at 13,000 feet. And Travis talked about earlier, we descend the aircraft, or I'll just say the procedure descends the aircraft down to 6,000 feet. And then eventually closer into the airport, the aircraft will then join the actual approach procedure and come down to the runway.
Great, thanks, appreciate that, Garrick. Mm-hmm. So folks, don't forget, you can still enter your questions as we're making our way through our allotted time today. We still want to hear from you. You can submit your questions at any time by entering them into the chat section here on Zoom. Or if you're watching this on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube, enter your questions in the Google form that's on your screen. And don't forget, the session today is being recorded. It'll be available immediately after this live session on those social media platforms, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. And I encourage you to go back and look at them and take the time to pause and look at especially the graphics in the opening videos, where you see those depictions of the arrival and departure routes and the proposed. You can see the comparisons from the proposed routes to the existing routes. Also, the video talked earlier, and I'd encourage you to take a really close look at the areas where the aircraft are in dispersal areas and the color coding, it's a little different shade, and you can see the aircraft spread out in those places where they're making turns or heading on course. So take your time, go back and watch that and look for all that information in there. We really do want you to be well-informed and have everything that you need to know. But we do want to hear from you here this afternoon as well. So if you've got that question that's just burning in the back of your mind that you're wanting to ask, please don't leave the session today without having asked your question. We've got a panel full of amazing experts here that are just anxious to answer your question. And you won't find a better collection of folks that can address pretty much anything you can ask. So this is your chance. Please take advantage of that. So, Garrick, here's a question that has come in that looks like it might fit in your area of expertise, sir. It says, will these changes be permanent, or could the routes change again in the future?
Well, I always tell my wife, nothing's permanent. Things are always going to change. So life changes, and guess what? Same thing with these procedures. Our existing procedures are changing. So as with the new procedures, there's always room for improvement. There are criteria that is established, and when the certain criteria is changed, we then have to accommodate that and make alterations to those. And if there's any kind of major change to any of these procedures, there is an environmental review process that is required. So that is always taken into consideration. So yes, it's always possible for change, but we'll go through the same process and do an environmental review.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. Appreciate that very much. So while you have the microphone, Garrick, let me throw this one at you too, if you don't mind. Our viewer says, will helicopters fly in the same locations as before? Will there be any changes to helicopter routes as we go forward here?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Now I got you. You froze up for a second. Now we got you.
Oh, sorry. So no changes. The helicopters fly. What the helicopters are flying currently, it will not change. They're flying point to point. And for example, a lot of them are airlife helicopters, and they fly as direct as possible to expedite to the point where they need to go and get the patients wherever to their destination. And so we try and make every attempt not to divert those aircraft. We will actually, for airlife at times, based on traffic, we actually stop traffic at San Antonio International, slight delay, get the aircraft across the helicopters across the runway and get them going to their point, and then resume operations. That's how important airlife is. But helicopters will not change. Same thing as police helicopters. They orbit and they fly around roads and things, and they monitor traffic situations, and those will not change at all.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate that. Now, this next question that just came in, maybe Travis and Trey, if you both would kind of take a shot at this one, I'd appreciate it. The question says, it looks like some of these stars tie into an approach, but the graphics show an area of dispersion. Why can't all aircraft stay on the procedure? So Travis, you want to start, and then Trey, maybe add?
Sure. So there's all sorts of different types of airplanes that fly into San Antonio. We got fast moving military aircraft, a medium speed Boeing 737, such as what Trey's flying with Southwest Airlines. And we have a number of smaller and therefore and slower general aviation aircraft that also land at San Antonio. And as we've stated a couple of times, we have a separation requirement. That's really what my primary job as a controller is to separate those aircraft. And when one is doing a speed such as, say, 90, and another is doing a speed, say, 250, then that I have to build some room there somehow. And if I have someone going 90 on the procedure and Trey comes in going 250, I have to build some extra room in there somehow. If I leave Trey on the procedure, then I will end up getting too close to the smaller aircraft that was in front of him. So that's the dispersion that you see, is that's air traffic controllers actually starting to assign vectors, or we'll issue them a heading to fly on the compass, in which case we'll tell them, all right, you're going to fly this heading, stay at this altitude, and then I will turn you back towards the airport when I have the amount of spacing that I need. In a perfect scenario, if everyone was doing the same speed, all coming from the same direction, already spaced out, sure, they could stay on that procedure all day long. But with San Antonio, we have airplanes coming from generally four different directions of all different types. And there's only one runway generally that they're going to land on at a time. And so the dispersion areas are where the air traffic controller is making it happen. They're making that separation occur.
Great. Thank you. Trey, anything you'd like to add from a pilot perspective as to any, how those dispersion areas come into play for you?
Well, just from the flight deck perspective, you know, really that's something that we just simply comply with. You know, our plan, if you will, is to descend out of altitude and bring the airplane down on, you know, what we call profiled descent. And you know, generally with procedures, there's speed restrictions. Obviously, there's altitude restrictions and speed restrictions that are part of federal regulations. And we're compliant with all of these restrictions. But generally, where you start to see some variation is when, you know, what exactly what Travis said, you know, is, you know, we're someone's either coming in faster than we are behind us or vice versa. I mean, there could be any number of scenarios where air traffic controllers, you know, they have to switch into their A game and be air traffic controllers. And so from that standpoint, you know, we are, you know, whether it be a 172 or a 737, I mean, we're in a compliance mode at that stage. And so we're just following our instructions.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate that from both of you. So we got a question here about our event for tomorrow night. It says, is the event on June 1st at 6 p.m. Central Time a repeat of today's event, or is it something different? So we will be live again tomorrow night with the same basic presentation, but we will be live and we'll be answering questions. So we welcome your questions. And if by chance you leave today and you think, oh, I wish I would have asked, tomorrow's again your opportunity to ask us that question live. So we will be back live again tomorrow. Same basic presentation, answering live questions on June 1st, 6 p.m. Central Time, right here on the same channels that you see us here today. So Steve, here's a question that that maybe you can help me with. Relates to one of the runways at San Antonio. And the viewer says, I apologize, I missed the beginning. What are the plans for 13 left and 31 right?
We're currently in the process of designing the runways to meet the master plan that was adopted last year. And there is some consideration given to 13 left and 13 right, but the pathway forward is not clear at this time. And so we are always aware that that runway does need some improvement. It has some pavement issues, and we are working on that as best we may to get it improved and return it to full. Well, it's useful now, but to improve its usefulness. Thank you.
Gotcha. Thanks, Steve. I appreciate that. And Steve, help me with, so you're talking about the airport improvement plan, the AIP plan, and that's a multi-year out into the future plan for all areas of your airport that what you do on the surface kind of supports and goes with what we're talking here today about these PBN procedures, right? Those two kind of work hand in glove, if you will.
Yes. Yes, they do. We're looking forward to having both runways available. It'll assist with those rare times when we have to close a runway for construction and things like that. So they all work together to improve service to the community.
Great. Thanks, Steve. Appreciate that very much. Travis and Trey, here's another one that maybe if you guys don't mind, get your each perspective on this one. The question says, on the video, it shows stars that are called waypoints, and it looks like there are a lot of these for each procedure. How do airplanes fly to these, and how do they know which waypoint to fly to? Anybody want to jump first, Trey or Travis?
Yeah, I'll jump in. So the way that these procedures are, let's just say, charted and coded, you know, pilots have a chart that is reflectant of the way that these procedures are built into our what's called a navigation database. And each one of these waypoints, we've called them, well, it's kind of a misnomer at this point, but they used to be called fixes on the conventional procedure or intersections. They're all associated with what's called a fixed makeup. In the terms of waypoints, which is specific to GPS, they're coded with a latitude longitude. And so those points in space are coded into our navigation database. So really what we do is we retrieve the specific procedures, have them loaded for us, and then the GPS sequences, and our navigation system sequences the waypoints for us as we go along the flight path.
Okay, great. Travis, anything you'd like to add?
No, you know, I always thought of the arrivals as kind of like a feeder road into a city. That's really what we have. We have a few highways in the sky that lead to the San Antonio International Airport. And those are made up by points in space. Like Trey said, those will be up once these procedures are in effect. He will have access to those in their database. We as controllers know exactly where they're at on our radar scope. and he'll be instructed to fly a specific arrival. And so we're both on the same page. I know exactly what point he's going to next, what altitude he will be at, and what speed he will be at each one of those points.
Great, thank you. And here's another question that just came in that maybe for both Travis and Trey again. Travis, if you'd like to start, the question says, I see RNP mentioned, but we've also heard about PBN. What's the difference?
So the RNP is basically the equipment that's on the airplane that is monitoring how accurate the equipment is, how closely they're following that flight path, for example. And that's, you know, earlier we talked a little bit about the safety of it. And, you know, there's with the old ground-based system, the further you got away from that, that ground-based system, really the wider your path that you were flying could become. Whereas with these systems with RNP, it is the system on board the airplane that keeps it within a very, very tight tolerance at all times. And it is monitoring that, as opposed to the PBN procedures. Those are basically another form of an RNAV procedure, or how we're using either just satellite-based or a combination of satellite-based and ground-based navigation.
Okay, great. Trey, anything you'd like to add from a pilot perspective to that on PBN and RNP?
Yeah, it's kind of a blender, if you will. Performance-based navigation is RNAV, which is area navigation, and coupled with RNP, and that's required navigation performance. And, really RNAV we're mostly familiar with from a technical standpoint. That's in a It's mostly GPS. There are a few other applications, but then when you get into the world of RNP, you're looking at systems that require onboard performance monitoring and alerting to add to the overall equation, which is performance-based navigation.
Great, thank you both. Appreciate that. Now here's a question about our process. Let me take a shot at this. It says, how do we continue to stay informed on what's happening with these procedures and potential noise impacts? So don't forget the public workshops conducted today and tomorrow will be recorded for future viewing and available virtually immediately when we're done here today on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and our community engagement webpage, which can be found at faa.gov. Any updates to materials will be found on the FAA's project website. So don't forget, we do have another live session tomorrow. This session is available, like I just said, immediately afterward on our social media channels. And we will have another session tomorrow, June 1st, 6 p.m. at Central Time. And it's on the same channels you're on now, whether you're on Zoom or if you're on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube. Please feel free to join us there. We would love to have you back and answer your questions at that time. So, Garrick, let me ask a question for you here, sir. It says, how does satellite based procedures enhance safety?
Right. For one thing, as everyone has been talking about, the procedures are already programmed into the aircraft, which means air traffic controllers don't have to keep adjusting the aircraft or asking them to descend to a certain altitude or be at a certain speed. And so a lot of these things are already going to be programmed into these new procedures. So it's going to be reducing the communication between air traffic control and the pilots. Also, it's going to be making the aircraft position more predictable based on the equipment that the aircraft have. And then greater navigational precision reduces the distance left or right, of course, where the aircraft is going to be. And also it decreases the controller workload during the busy times because, like I said earlier, there's less communication. And a lot of times, based on if all the aircraft are going to be flying the same route, there's less communication and the air traffic controller will just have to monitor and watch and look for safety issues that might exist. And that's pretty much it. It's pretty great. Efficient.
Awesome. Thanks, Garrick. I appreciate that. And Garrick, while you've got the mic, let me ask you this one. Steve mentioned a minute ago from the airport, we talked a little bit about 1-3 left and 3-1 right. Will there be any new RNP procedures or approaches for 1-3 left, 3-1 right connected with this proposal?
So right now, there's nothing proposed at all. what has to happen is basically what Steve has been talking about. Any decision has to be made first based on the runway. So for 13 left, 31 right, airliners do not, I'm not going to expound too much, but basically they're not allowed to land on that runway unless an emergency exists. It's the airliner runway is runway 13 right, 31 left. So the 13 left, 31 right is a much smaller runway and is primarily used for general aviation aircraft to land. And there are no instrument approach procedures. There aren't any procedures at all for that runway that's being asked on 13 left, 31 right. And the aircraft, they just fly in visually. They see the runway and they fly in visually to that runway. Whereas opposed to runway 13 right, 31 left, the one we're talking about, with the instrument approaches, the aircraft can either fly in visually or use these new instrument approaches, these new procedures that we have.
Great. Thanks, Garrick. Appreciate that. Trey, here's a question for you. It says, does using satellite navigation impact glide speed or affect noise level of arriving airplanes?
So that's a very astute question. There are temperature limitations that can affect RNAV glide paths. And, for example, a colder than standard temperature would result in a shallower glide path angle. And then the reverse would be true of hotter than standard. It would be steeper. In a lot of cases, the FAA charts temperature limits for RNAV procedures, which, we have to stay within those limits. Or otherwise, either apply an alternate method or we can't use the procedure, depending on what the procedure is. But in the case of San Antonio, I haven't seen anything that indicates that there's going to be, extreme temperatures that would result in a variation. If anything, it would be, my guess would be, it would be hot and we would come in steeper and quieter. But again, really good question.
Awesome. Thanks. Appreciate that, Trey. All right. Well, we've just about used up all of our time. We have time for one more question. So let me send this one to Travis and Garrick. Maybe you might want to weigh in. But Travis, how do you know the new procedures will be safe?
Well first, like we've said a few times on here, that these procedures, while they're using GPS satellites primarily to guide them on the procedure, where they're flying is pretty much where we're flying at today. So we already know that it is in a good spot in our airspace. These procedures are built around what we already do today. It's just, they're going to be using their GPS to fly them as opposed to a ground-based NAVAID. So, and they're work for us now. And so we expect they'll continue to work for us today. As far as the speeds and the altitudes and knowing that they're safe, there's a lot to be said about being able to know exactly what altitude and what airspeed an aircraft is going to be at any given point. Whereas today, I have to watch that airspeed. I have to watch that altitude constantly. And every pilot is going to fly that arrival just a little bit differently today. Whereas when these procedures are implemented, the safety is increased simply by knowing, being able to kind of tie them down and knowing exactly what speed and altitude they're going to be at. I know that the air carrier side that helped design these has already taken them and flown them in simulators, and they've done them at various weights, different temperatures, different wind situations, and they've proven them in the simulator that they're safe, and we know that they're going to work for us already. We've spent a lot of time and put a lot of work into making sure that they're going to work and do well for us.
Great. Thanks, Travis. Great explanation. Garrick, anything else you'd like to add from the air traffic control side?
Something briefly is San Antonio International is not the first airport to get these procedures. Performance-based navigation has been an ongoing program around the United States. And so we're not trying to reinvent the wheel here. This is something that's existing, and we're just adapting what other facilities are already using and actually enjoying reaping the benefits of, and we're trying to get it to San Antonio.
Awesome. Thank you both. And as always, the FAA's first priority, as is everyone in the National Airspace System, it's always safety, right? So explanations. And well, we've reached the end of our time, folks. And thank you so much for being here. A huge thank you to our amazing panel, Travis, Garrick, Stephen, and Trey, and Vivian Nichols, our Spanish interpreter. Thank you so much for that. We're so glad that you were here today. Thank you for attending. We've heard many good questions, and I hope our answers were informative. If you'd like to view this workshop again, please visit the FAA platforms on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. But this isn't the end of our communication. We also want to remind you that the FAA is performing an environmental assessment to analyze potential environmental impacts. Once we have the results of that study, we will be sharing them with you. We also want you to know that you may comment on this proposal. Please go to our website, which you see on the screen. It's faa.gov/air_traffic/community_engagement/SANANT. And you might wonder what that last little bit, that stands for San Antonio. So it's SANANT. Again, it's faa.gov/air_traffic/community_engagement/SANANT/. An alternative, if that's too long for you, is to go to faa.gov and search for San Antonio. You can click on the community engagement link, or if you have your phone handy, you can simply scan the QR code on your screen and it will take you to that website. Once you go to the page, scroll to the bottom and you'll see a link that you may click to submit your comments. Or if you prefer, there is a mailing address and you can mail your comments to us. Please note that all comments must be received by June 30th, 2022. Once again, I want to thank our specialists for providing their expertise. We will have one more workshop tomorrow at 6 p.m. Central Time. Remember, this workshop is being recorded, and that recording, including all of these slides, the addresses here, and the QR code, will be available on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter right after we conclude today. Thanks for being here. Have a great afternoon.